Today we're talking about fear. Fear is our topic, and I thought, let me just tell you a little. Finally, thank you, my man, back on the front row. I want to tell you a little bit about myself. Man, I grew up a fearful kid. I was afraid of, like, everything. I mean, growing up, I slept with my head under the covers. I don't know if anyone has done that. I slept with my head under the covers until I was, like, 14 years old. But I remember my parents would come in and pray with me, and then when they would leave, I would duck my head under the covers, and I would pull the covers over my head, and then I would take a finger and just poke a tiny little air hole. And so then I could breathe out of this little hole, and then I could keep one eye on that hole, and I could see my room. Because we all know that if you're not under the covers or if you close your eyes, that's when the boogeyman can come out, or that's when the monsters can get you. So I thought, as long as I keep that eye open and I keep looking out my little air hole as I'm sitting there just sweating, you know, just completely under all these covers sweating. And I slept like that for a long time. I had a nightlight growing up. We called them these little plug-in lights that plugged into the wall, and we called them nightlights so that I could see the room. But man, I was a scared kid. And as I got older, I got afraid of more things. I remember I got completely messed up. I remember getting afraid of the movie Jurassic Park because it had these raptors in it. You know, I'm pretty sure everyone's seen Jurassic Park. But I remember watching Jurassic Park, and then I remember I was house sitting. It's crazy that I remember this. And I went next door to let the dogs out of the garage, and I walked down in this deep garage, in this like dark garage, and I'm like, there's raptors in here. I know those things are in here, you know? And you do that thing where you run as fast as you can to get to the light switch and flick it on. That stuff, man, I was just fearful. I was a fearful, fearful kid. In our basement in my parents' house, there was one lamp. So it was a three-story house, and you went downstairs to go into the basement. It was a finished basement. We had a fireplace down there, and we had a TV, and that was kind of like our den where we hung out, watched TV. And at the end of the night, when you had to turn the light off, there was like one lamp. It was all the way on the other side of the room. And then we had this sliding glass door, and we lived next to the woods. And so I'd sit there and look at that lamp and be like, okay, I got to get to that lamp, turn it off, prevent the monsters from murdering me, and then get to the bottom of the stairs, and then get up the stairs. And if you guys have ever had that feeling of like walking up the stairs when it's dark behind you, and you know, the first couple steps, you're like, no, I'm not afraid. I'm cool. And then you get about three or four steps in, and your brain's like, something's gonna get your ankle, you know? And you start running faster and faster up the stairs. That was like a nightly thing for me. I was just a scared kid. You know, another funny story to do with stairs is growing up, to get into the back of my parents' house, we had a deck. We had wooden stairs, and we had a lot of like flowers around, so there were a lot of like bees and yellow jackets and wasps and hornets. And when we would pull into the driveway, I would sit in my car and I would watch and wait and see what was like buzzing around and stuff. And Casey will attest to this. I'm probably the most afraid of bees than I am anything else. And I will throw you in front of a bee. If a bee comes into our house and it gets near me, I will throw you in front of it. I have actually, I'm not proud to admit this, but I have actually caused my wife to get stung by a bee because I threw her in front of this bee and I ran. And she got stung. But my brother and I used to sprint. Mom and Dad always knew when we were home because, you know, these two big boys, we would just sprint up these wooden steps and it would shake the whole house. But you had to get up the steps, you had to get the screen door open, closed behind you, and then there was always like one wasp that was in the screened-in porch. So it's just right there. And so then, you know, had to get into the door. But yeah, I was just a scared kid. Looking back on it, it's like, man, I was afraid of like a lot of stuff. And then as I grew up, I graduated into new fears. You know, I probably still slept with my head under the covers, but then, you know, you go to school and then you're afraid of like looking weird, or I was always afraid of fitting in, or, you know, you're afraid of you know, am I going to ask somebody to go to the dance? Are they going to ask me to go to this dance? You know, all these like little fears kind of creep in. And then as I grew up and got even older, I kept graduating and I kept becoming more and more afraid of more and more things. And that leads me to a really fun place of adult fears, grown-up fears. And those are fears that a lot of us have. where it's like, am I going to be able to pay, you know, the loan on the house? Am I going to be able to keep the water on? Am I going to be able to keep lights on? Am I going to be able to continue to live with my spouse? Am I going to be able to make it through, you know, my family member being sick or whatever? We have all these like grown-up fears. Now, I remember, tell you, a grown-up fear of mine was the day that I got on the airplane to move to South Africa. So I'd sold everything I owned, and I had been living in my parents' house, and I sold everything that I owned except for what fit into like two duffel bags. And I had quit a great paying job, and I got on that airplane and was flying to leave to come move to South Africa permanently. And as that plane took off, I just thought, you stupid idiot, what have you done? And there's this overwhelming amount of fear of like, oh my goodness, what have I just done? And I'm thankful for that, because otherwise I wouldn't be here. But my hope in just sharing all these things about myself is, as I realized as I was preparing for this message, I mean, obviously we're going to talk about fear, and we're going to talk about how you can have fear no more, how you can, you know, fear no more a lot of the things that we're afraid of. But my hope is I hope that you can identify with something that I've said. I hope that you can identify with think about when you were little, like even like those weird tiny little fears that you have, and then graduating up to those bigger fears, and then graduating up to the even bigger, you know, more grown-up fears. I hope that you can identify with that, because I think right now is the time in our lives where we are crippled with fear. There is just absolute, utter fear that has grabbed people. And rightfully so. I mean, we're in this pandemic. We've got, you know, the economy keeps taking hit after hit after hit. You know, we feel like we take a couple steps forward and then we take a couple steps back. And there's just fear. There's so much fear. When we talk to people in the medical industry or when we talk with friends, you know, outside of the church, they talk about how like just terrified they are. They're afraid of getting sick. They're afraid of getting other people sick. I mean, people are just scared right now. And so I thought, well, why don't we address that? Why don't we just address the amount of fear that so many people are carrying around? Because fear feeds so much of what's in our life. It feeds us and it controls us. So while I continue with this sermon, I want you to think about, what is the thing that you're afraid of? And I don't mean that in a super spiritual way. It could be spiritual, but it could also be practical. It could be, well, I'm afraid of the fact that my bank account says zero and I still have, you know, how many days till the end of the month? You know, it could be somebody being sick. It could be whatever. It could be a bullying situation. You know, it could be whatever. But whatever it is, I want you to think about that as we go through this. So I thought, let me unpack fear a little bit, because we're going to talk about Jesus, and Jesus is going to tell us how we can kind of deal with fear and how we can fear no more. But before we get to what I think is an incredibly pivot-changing sort of verse in the Bible, I want to unpack some truths about fear that we ascribe to. And the first truth is the unknown. So the thing that makes us afraid, the thing that a lot of times is so fear and enticing, is something being unknown. It's like, you know, a lot of people that struggle with anxiety or depression, or especially anxiety and panic attacks, a lot of it's the fear of the unknown. Like, I'm afraid of what I don't know or what I don't understand. I'm afraid that it's like, you know, what's going to happen when I get home, and you know, what environment am I going to walk into? I don't know. Or something's out of your control at work, or something's out of your control in life. And there's this huge unknown that's in your life. And that unknown, that part of you just not knowing everything or not having a grasp on what it's going to be, even if it's something silly, even if it's something really, really silly. Like a silly thing for me that I'll share is I'm constantly terrified that one of my neighbors is going to throw like a huge party. Now, we live in Cape Town. Everyone lives right on top of each other, and everyone hears everyone's everything. But for me, that's a big trigger of my anxiety. Is like something that's out of my control. And so because it's out of my control and I can't, you know, determine what my neighbors do or don't do, like every Friday night, guess what? I get a little bit scared, because I'm like, what's going to happen on Friday night? Is there going to be a party? Is there not going to be a party? Are there students? living nearby? Are they not living by me? You should try being my wife when we look at houses to rent. I do like full background checks on all the neighbors. I do a recon. I hire people to sit in cars outside of houses and take notes on who comes. No, I don't do all that. But I wish I could. I wish I could, you know? But it makes the fear of the unknown of what's going to happen on a Friday or Saturday night for me, which is a silly thing. It's a silly thing, but it drives so much of me. It takes so much of my life. And I know that there's, you know, I'm happy to use myself as an example because I feel like there's stuff that we all have. I feel like there's things that we all struggle with. But it comes down to there's this unknown, and that's why I'm afraid. Now, the second truth that I want to talk about is the protection of self. So because you don't understand something, or because there's a great unknown, then what rises up in you is I have to protect myself. I have to change my situation. I have to control my situation. I have to take an active step. I have to do something to protect myself. I've got to take control of the unknown. I've got to try and influence the unknown. I've got to try and make some kind of change so that the unknown becomes more known. But whatever it is, I've got to do something that is protecting of myself. And we buy into this illusion that if I can just do X, Y, and Z, then I can protect myself and therefore my fear will go away. You know, so many people have stayed locked up in their houses for like a year and a half now. And believe me, I'm not being critical of that at all. Not even a little bit. But there's this fear, this protection of, I don't even want to leave my house. I want to protect myself. And for some people, that's the absolute right thing to do. And for other people, there's an enormous amount of fear. There's an enormous amount of weight. And you'll do anything to protect yourself. Now, the third truth that I want to talk about, and you know, these things are not in the Bible. I mean, they are. But as I came up with these four truths, it's going to be four in the end, I really just thought about myself and thought about the things that I'm afraid of from the time I was a little kid all the way up until yesterday. And that's where I kind of came up with these things. But the third truth about fear is if we had a guarantee, then the fear would go away. So if I could have a guarantee from the Secret Service that all of my neighbors were 85 years old and none of them did anything and the neighborhood would be completely silent, then I would never be stressed on a Friday night. Or if I had a guarantee that I was walking into what would be an unknown situation where I feel like I need to protect myself, if somebody could address that issue and give me a guarantee that it's not going to happen or it's not going to impact me or affect me, then I would not be afraid. See, this is another illusion. We think to ourselves, if you take out the unknown, if you take out the need for me to protect myself, and instead, if you give me a guarantee, then my fear is going to go away. So whatever it is that you're afraid of, whatever it is that you're thinking about, whatever it is that drives your anxiety or drives your depression or whatever it is that drives your worry, whatever it is that kind of makes you feel sick to your stomach on a Monday morning when you're on your way to work or on a Saturday or whatever it is. You know, for some of the dads out there, you know, when the babies are crying and you're like, man, do I want to be a dad? Man, do I want this? Is this something that, you know, there's this fear of like, can I be a good father? Man, if I just had a guarantee, then I wouldn't be afraid. If I had a guarantee that I could do this right or do this well, then I wouldn't be afraid. So take whatever your fear is, whatever fears affect your life, take that fear. Think about how the unknown in your life feeds that fear. And then think about how much you are driven to self-protection and how much you will do in order to protect yourself so that you don't have to deal with that fear. And then think about that fear in the context of, man, if I just had a guarantee, then I would not be afraid. Now, I can't give us all a guarantee. I wish that I could. I'll go ahead and throw it up. The fourth truth, this is the ultimate truth, is this. Jesus is our key. Now, for a lot of people, including myself, this doesn't actually mean anything to me. Because when you're in the middle of being afraid of life or afraid of a situation or afraid of reality or truth that you're up against, and someone says, hey, man, Jesus, Jesus. It's like, okay, now I have fear and Jesus. My fear, nothing's actually happened. Now instead, I feel guilty because I should be praying to Jesus and my fear should go away. But instead, when I pray to Jesus about my fear, it makes me think more about my fear. And now I feel more afraid. And then I feel more guilty because I'm supposed to talk to this God that's up above in heaven. He's supposed to take all this fear away. But instead, I'm praying about it. Now I'm thinking about it. And now I'm more afraid. Now I'm stressed. And then you get stressed, or I get stressed, to the point of, okay, now I've got to protect myself. I've got to remove myself from this situation, or I've got to do something. I've got to go find another guarantee somewhere that way it'll take away my fear. And that's it's a pattern that we get stuck in. It's this fear pattern. It's this thing that whether it's a small fear or an irrational fear or this very legitimate big fear, we get stuck in this pattern, and then for some reason, we get hit with this truth that Jesus is our key. Jesus is the key to not being afraid, and we're like, but what does that even mean? You know, when I go over these sermons and these messages, and I think about what I want to tell you, what I want to communicate with you, I think like, but does that actually mean something? Does that actually help? If it's not something that I can apply to my life, then I know that it would be really hard to apply to your life. Because I know I'm messed up. You guys hired one messed up dude to lead this church. And so the only thing I know how to do is just be open and be honest with you and communicate and also let my messed up self just be open to God and say, God, what would help me? And then funnel that and try and communicate that to you guys. So I desperately hope that it helps you. I hope that it opens up God's voice to you, that you can hear something that actually helps. So today, my goal is to help us take one mind shift, one change of mind. It's a tiny change of mind to be able to wrap our heads around why Jesus is the key to dealing with our fear. That's all I want to do today. I'm not going to take your fear away. I'm not going to give you something that every time you're afraid, you can pull out, you know, a card and you can say these things and then boom, you know, because then we're all walking around like weirdos with cards in front of us, you know, just claiming, you know, everything to everything. But I want to give you something concrete, something inside. I want to give you something that just plants in your soul, plants in your heart. So that when these things happen, or when you get afraid, or when you get anxious, or when you get depressed, this thing that's planted in your heart just comes out and it sprouts out and it just brings life to you. And it becomes the key, it becomes the guarantee that you can actually lean on so that you don't have to protect yourself and you don't have to be afraid of the unknown. That's what I hope to do today. And we're going to do that. We're going to look at a story in Matthew. Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 through 16. We're not going to read all of these verses, but I wanted to put this on the screen because if you want to look at this at home, or if you want to look at this later, if you go back and watch this message, then the first part of this story is Matthew 10, 1 through 16. And what this is where Jesus commissions and instructs his disciples. So to give you a short summary and a short kind of catch up to where this is Jesus has just called his 12 disciples to him. Jesus has been, he's been working with them, they've been following him for a while, and he's just called them to him. And so Jesus gathers his disciples around, and they've been watching Jesus do stuff. They've been watching him cast out demons, they've been watching him heal people, they've watched him raise people, they've watched him do amazing things with people. They've been around Jesus for a while, and so Jesus is like, okay, come on. Now it's time for you guys to get off of milk and to get onto some meat. It's time for you guys to grow up in your faith your spiritual walk a little bit. And so what he does, he gathers them around. And in these first 16 verses, he says, I want you guys to go out. I'm going to give you instructions. And he goes through an incredibly detailed list of things for the disciples to do. He tells the disciples, I want you to go to these places. I want you to go to these cities. I don't want you to take any money. I don't want you to carry an extra cloak. I don't want you to worry about this and worry about that. And I mean, you can read it for yourself. But Jesus so specifically outlines it out. It's like he knew that the disciples were a bit, you know, dense. There had been many situations before this where he had looked at the disciples and said, do you still not believe? Why are we still dealing with this? Why? Come on, grow. And so he says, finally, you know what? I know how to make you guys grow. I'm going to send you out to do what you've been doing with me or what you've been watching me do. I'm going to send you out to do it. So he gives them all these instructions. And as that would be comforting to me. I'd be like, okay, I know exactly what to do. I know exactly how to do it. I know exactly what to do. And that's when we come to verse 17 here, or verse 16. And it starts right here with this. So Jesus has just told them exactly how to do what he wants them to do. He's even told them what houses to go to. He's told them when to come to a house and when to leave a house. He's even told them what to do if they face rejection. You know, it's they shake the dust off their sandals, which is like an old-timey, like one of these things, which I think went out in the 2000s. But anyway, it starts here, and Jesus says this. His disciples are around him, just given instructions. And then he says, I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. And then he goes on. The disciples are probably thinking, did he just say like wolves, like sheep? Like, are we the sheep? Who's, okay. Then Jesus says, be on your guard. You will be handed over to local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. Now, the interesting thing about flogging is that was like a permanent mark because it was permanent scars. So Jesus is like, hey, you're going to be like sheep to wolves, and guess what? You're going to get flogged. It's going to be, you got to believe in you guys. I believe you guys can do this. Go learn. And he goes on in verse 18, on my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. And then it goes on. Now, the interesting thing about Gentiles is Jesus had originally in his instructions told them, hey, you are going to go out to the Jews. So what's happening when he brings the Gentiles in the equation is, see, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those are about Jesus. Acts, those are about, that's about what the disciples do after Jesus. Jesus is kind of speaking into the future. He's like, this is what's coming for you. This is the life that's on its way. So get ready. And he goes on to say, but when they arrest you, okay, arrest. By now, I'm sure the disciples are like, you ever get nervous? Who's a nervous sweater, you know? If you ever see me sweating profusely on stage, it means I have no clue what I'm talking about. So, but when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. That's assuring. It's like, hey, you're going to get arrested. Don't even try and talk your way out of it. The Holy Spirit will cover it. You're not going to give any note cards. Don't do any research. Don't try and be wise or crafty or talk your way out of a situation. I gotcha. It's fine. In the moment, like literally the moment before you need the word, I'll give you the word. That's comforting. Verse 20 goes on to say, for it will not, or sorry, thanks, Philippe upstairs, keeping me on track. Brother will betray brother to death and a father his child. Children will rebel against parents and have them put to death. Jesus is painting a picture of the world that they're going into. You will be hated by everyone because of me. See, at the time when the disciples are with Jesus, everyone loves Jesus and everyone loves the disciples. I mean, he's walking around like a walking miracle. And the disciples are like, we are part of the cool crew. We are like Ronda Bosch, A-team, rugby. I'm glad I got laughs at that. My son goes to Ronda Bosch. And those guys, you know, they're big top dogs there. Side note, it's crazy how, this is a true side note, it's crazy how bullying is so big. And my hope is that there's a generation that rises up in this country that just says no to being a bully. And I constantly try and teach Leifa, who's 13 and he's in grade 8, I'm like, you know what happens when a matric who can be a bully graduates? They become a nobody. Because they go to university or they get a job and they start at the bottom all over again. And just, so anyway, that's a whole nother sermon. I'm sorry. So, verse 22, Jesus tells them, you will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end, they will be taken care of. So do not be afraid of them. Okay, after if you were told all of those things, like if I'm up here, I'm not don't even pretend I'm Jesus, but let's say you've all signed up for a mission trip and we're going to send you out. And I'm like, okay, you're going to get beaten. You're going to get arrested. You're going to have all these things that's going to happen to you. Oh, and by the way, don't be afraid of any of them. Like, it's totally going to be cool. Probably, I don't know how the disciples felt about that. Probably not great. For there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. So I just wanted, that paints the picture of where the disciples are. And now the next verse that I give you, this is the pivot point. Think about how fearful of a situation this could be. Now this is the pivot point that makes Jesus the key. This is the verse. This is the thing that I hope soaks in and changes something about the way you think about fear. And it's Matthew 10, 28, and it says this, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell." Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. So what does that mean? See, what Jesus is doing with this verse right here, what he's doing with this statement, is Jesus is creating a list of priorities for you and for me and for the disciples. What is not at the top of the priority list? The body. You know what represents the body? The earth, the flesh, the things that are happening in our life, the things that we're up against in our life, the things that come up against us in our life. You know, the car wreck or the sick relative or the job that you've lost or the bank account that isn't growing but it's shrinking or whatever it is. That's the body. Jesus is saying, hey, don't be afraid of the world and the worldly things and the things that can impact your body, because they can't touch your soul. So Jesus is laying this priority list. He's saying all these things that you think are number one are not. What's actually number one in the priority list is your soul. The soul is eternal. The soul is untouchable when Jesus has it. The soul is something that is impressionable by the Holy Spirit. The soul is something that's the thing that lasts forever. The reason Jesus came and he died is not so that we remain in our bodies after we die and so that we never grow old and we never age. It's this thing that we have on us doesn't go with us when we die. This is not the eternal thing. The thing that's eternal is the thing that's inside. And Jesus is laying that out here and he's saying, don't worry about the things of the world. Don't worry about the body. Worry about the soul. I'm setting the soul as the priority. I came and I died for the soul. I came and I gave my life for the soul. So when you've got fears in your life, when fear comes up against you, or you come up against fear, think to yourself, is this an attack on my soul or an attack on my body? When my neighbors throw a party and my anxiety rises and I feel like I'm under attack and all of a sudden there's this unknown and then all of a sudden, you know, I need to protect myself. It's like, you know what actually would help me other than anxiety medication? What helps me is to realize and remember that, you know what? I don't need to worry about the body. Am I going to die tonight? No, I'm okay. Because the Lord is Lord of my soul. Now, this doesn't mean that you don't have hard days. It doesn't mean you don't get sick. It doesn't mean that you know, you don't wreck the car. It doesn't mean that the geyser doesn't fall through the ceiling in your house or whatever it is. It doesn't mean that those things don't happen. What it means is that you've got your priorities set in the way that Jesus wanted to set your priorities, by setting the soul as the top priority and then letting the body and everything else come after that. Now he goes on to say, rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. So Jesus is saying, hey, be afraid of me. And the fear that he talks about here is a fear that we can see, and we don't have time to go to it. But in Mark chapter 4, verse 40, Jesus is on a boat and the disciples are in a storm and Jesus is asleep. And the disciples, they wake Jesus up and they say, Jesus, we've got this storm. Why are you sleeping? And Jesus wakes up and he says, why are you afraid? And they say, well, we've got this big storm. And he says, well, what about your faith? And they say, well, what about the storm? And Jesus calms the storm. And then it says in the Bible, it says that the disciples looked at him and they were terrified. And the reason they were terrified is because they got a glimpse of the one who is the authority of both the soul and body in heaven and on earth and in hell. The disciples saw Jesus as the king, the provider, the creator. And when they saw Jesus in that way, they were terrified. But it was a fear of respect. It was a fear that demanded authority. And when they got that, when they saw that, when they encountered that, it was this awe, this respect, this humbleness in them that said, wow, we've never seen somebody that reigns with authority like that over everything. And that's what Jesus is asking us here in Matthew. That's what Matthew is talking about. Matthew is saying, hey, I want you to know that Jesus is Lord of it all. Every fear that we have relates to our body. It relates, most of them, 99.9% of everything we're afraid of comes down to the things that are of the world that impact us. It's the bank account, it's the car, it's the geezer, it's the relationship, it's the spouse, it's the other person, it's whatever it is. But Jesus is saying, like, hey, I am Lord. And I want you to always remember that soul and Lord and Jesus and love and the Heavenly Father, that's all here. Everything else is down here in the priority list. Now, I want to go through a couple examples. Now, I've got to do this quick. I want to get to everything, but let's go to the next verse here. Jesus goes on to give them a couple examples because he wants them to have practical examples. And he says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs on your head are all numbered. In verse 31, he says, so don't be afraid. So Jesus is like, I take care of the birds. I know how many hairs are on your head. Don't be afraid. He just dropped this bomb on them. And then now he's like, hey, let me give you, don't be afraid. You know, if we look in our life, we can all find sparrows in our life. We can all find places where, man, if Jesus is taking care of this, this, and this, why am I afraid? You know, when anxiety creeps up in me and fear creeps up in me, I can look for the sparrows in my life, and I can say, oh, my goodness, look at what, I mean, I got a closet full of clothes. I got 8 tires on 2 vehicles. They all got air in them. I've got this amazing wife, this amazing family. I can count my sparrows. Now, when I count my sparrows, then it helps me remember that, oh, man, Jesus is Lord. He's Lord of the soul, and I'm okay, and I'm going to be okay. Now, the last example I want to give is an example of Paul. Paul is a guy that he's written some verses that we quote all the time, and I want to bring these verses up, and I want you to think about the man of Paul when he said these things. The first verse that we'll turn to is this right here. It's Romans 8, 28. And it says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Now, I just want you to know that in this time, Paul has been beaten. He's been shipwrecked. Paul has been traveling around, taking the gospel to the Gentiles. Paul has been almost stoned to death. Paul has been through it. He's been through more. He's been given more reason to be fearful than any other person on earth. And Paul sits here and he writes these words, and we know that in all things God works for the good. How can a man that's been through so much like that, that's been through the shipwrecks, that's been through the beatings, that's been through the attacks, that's had his reputation dragged through the dirt, how can that kind of man say, and we know that in all things God works for the good? Let's go to the next verse. Romans 8:35. Paul goes on and he continues to write this here. They'll pop it up on the screen for you. He says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? I mean, again, think about from a perspective of fear. Think about everything Paul's gone through. Paul's gone through everything that the disciples were told they would go through. Paul eventually would lose his life on behalf of Christ. And Paul is writing this. He's saying, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship, because he went through it and he still feels connected to Christ, or persecution or famine? Paul and many times says, whether I was hungry or whether I had enough food, whether I was starving. I mean, Paul is saying in persecution and famine or in nakedness or danger of sword or in the divorce or in the bankruptcy, or in the car wrecks, or in the death in the family, or in the anxiety and the depression, in the self-doubt, in the emptiness, in the loneliness that you carry, in the unwavering questions of why, trying to make sense of things. Paul is saying, in the middle of all that, what or who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Nobody and nothing. Tim, you can come on out. I'm going to have Tim create a little ambiance for us. I've got one more verse for us. It's in John 16:33, and it says this. This is something that Jesus was leaving his disciples with. This is one of the last things that Jesus was telling them in a conversation that he had. And it says, Jesus says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. That takes me back to that pivoting verse in Matthew 16 where Jesus says, hey, don't fear the thing that can hurt the body. Instead, have awe, have reverence, have fear of me, Lord of your soul, because that's the priority. That's why Jesus can say, in this world you will have trouble. We all have had trouble. We just did a funeral here yesterday. There's families that have had trouble. We're all in the middle of trouble. We're all in the middle of fear. We're all being driven by fear in some way. And in that, we're afraid of some kind of trouble. And we can turn to people like Paul and gain encouragement and look at the words that he wrote and think, wow, how did he write those things in the middle of feeling the fear, in the middle of those fear-inducing situations? How on earth was Paul able to write those things? I think it's because Paul understood and he got just a sliver of truth from that verse that says, do not be afraid of the things that can hurt the body. Be afraid of the one that is king over everything, earth, heaven, hell, body, soul, all of it. And then Jesus is getting ready to send the disciples off as he's getting ready to go to the cross, as they're getting ready to have the Lord's Supper. Jesus says, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. I'll take peace. I'll take some of that all day long. Please, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. I mean, how amazing is that truth? But how hard is it to grasp that truth? Because in the middle of all this, you can hear this sermon 100 times over. I can preach this sermon to myself 1,000,000 times over. I do it every time I look in the mirror every day. Think, take heart, Chris. Take heart. Jesus is Lord over your life. There is no fear. There is no shame. There is no condemnation. There's no room for any of it. Take heart. Because Jesus is Lord over my soul. Now that's the security that I have, and I'll fight for it. And when I don't have the energy to fight for it, Jesus fights for it for me. Because it's a truth. And because it's an established truth, it's something that even the Holy Spirit will act on your behalf. So if you're too weak, if you're too afraid, or if you don't even know Jesus, and you've somehow tuned into this, this thing here, take heart, I've overcome the world, is still for you. All you have to do is accept Jesus. The disciples didn't believe in him. That's why they woke him up when there was a storm. That's why they hid when Jesus was nailed to the cross. Because they thought, oh man, our Father, the guy that was supposed to be the Messiah is dead. But Jesus still said, take heart, I've overcome the world. And he came back and he brought them into the truth that he came and he died for them, that he is the resurrected Lord, and he is that for us as well. And so my prayer for you guys today is that this just touches something in you that's fearful. I pray it's like water running through cracks of concrete, that it just finds its way down in whatever crack you have, whatever little doubt, whatever little fear it is, it just finds its way down and it just soaks it in the Holy Spirit. It just soaks it in the truth of God, soaks it in God's word. So let's bow our heads and I'm going to pray, and then we're gonna do a worship song, and then I'll come up and dismiss this. But Lord, thank you so much for what you do. Thank you so much, Father, that you came so that we don't have to be fearful. Thank you, Father, that you're a part of our fears, whether we're young or whether we're old or whether it's silly things like movies or whether it's big things like health or finances or all the things that we're dealing with, a pandemic that's still running around in the world. Father, we give you all of our fear. And I just pray, Lord, that in this last worship song, whether people are here in the room or whether they're watching online, I pray, Father, that you would just awaken in them the places where they just need to let you be Lord. And I pray, Father, that people will take their priorities to you and let the soul be the priority and accept the truth that you came and you died for the soul and everything you do is for our soul. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.